meeting is 6:30. Get started. That was a call order for the school board.
Which over here? Call order for the board supervisor. And going to the opening comments by board supervisors. So start down with Mr. Frazier. You have anything you'd like to say about tonight? Mr. Smith?
Thank you to everyone for the hospitality this evening. It's really always a great time to get together and start doing our budget projections every year. We appreciate your hospitality.
I would like to echo that. Thank you so much for having us on Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day.
Yep, thanks very much. And Dr. Grimsley and your team, as always, I'm grateful for how much work you put into your annual budget presentation, and it's makes our job a lot easier. It gives us a lot more confidence when out talking to our constituents that you're doing everything in your power to run a perfect school while doing it as inexpensively as possible, which is an impossible combination. But thank you for all you do.
I'm going to repeat on the thank yous. I know setting this up, I think Dr. Gold, Mr. Curry maybe did a lot of the setup. I don't know if we had extras, but this is not simple, but much appreciated. And hopefully, like this evening, will be better for everyone in the audience to hear what's going on. And just want to say that although this is the early part of the budget season, it's nice to get together in case there's any key issues that we need to be really looking into now and preparing for. This is a good time to get kickstarted on the focus on those items. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
How's everyone hearing out there? Can you hear the board when we speak? Some. Okay. Hey, so it's important and aggravating, right? So as we're speaking, if there's something, you know, you can use sign language. It's like this, right? So that we know. So that you don't become too aggravated.
And Mr. Chairman, I'll just add that now the system is tied into the entire speaker system in this room, so it works really well as long as you speak into the microphone.
Yeah. Okay. So it's just the cheerleader in chief.
What's the appropriate distance for our faces to be from the mic when we speak?
Right up here. Okay. You're speaking, please lean in. Thank
Great.
You.
Thanks. Motion, Ms. Bond, is there a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. Hoopman, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, no.
We have a motion from the board to adopt the agenda.
So,
go ahead. We have a motion and a second.
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you.
It's like the first thing is our school board student liaison, plural, coming to join us. Hey, when you go up, would you please introduce yourselves again for everyone that's here?
And the same thing, speak into the microphone.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
You got to turn it on.
Turn it on.
So we got it.
Sorry.
There you go. Good evening. Yeah. Hi, I'm Majette, as many of you know, and to like those who don't, it's nice to meet you. I am the Rappahannock High School student liaison. And I just come to give short synopsis of what's going on in school. A lot of activities have been going on, a lot of programs are doing very good this year. Band has been traveling a lot. They've been working on the music program this year. They begun to play in, we've had opportunities to play in the International Saxophone Convention, the Bridgewater Symphonic Band, and seven students participated in the Tri-County Honor Band and Pinkton Chili. Silla. Played in the district band. Okay. This one is very, very dear to me, but our varsity scholastic bowl team has done very good this season and we've made the stakes.
That's awesome.
We will be competing in Williamsburg at Jameson High School at 10 a.m. on the 25th, anybody who wants to come. Yeah. And we get the site team in Williamsburg the day before. Girls varsity basketball is still doing amazing. They have district semifinals on the 15th at 7 p.m. And like, they're doing pretty good. I think we all know they'll win. And for individual student recognition, Will Newman has qualified to advance to the Virginia State High School League State Championship for wrestling. And my friend, Butter, who's also my co-student liaison, he is doing a very prestigious international student program. It's called the Youth Exchange, the Bundestag Youth Exchange Program. And it's sponsored by the U.S. government and the German federal government. And in the long term, it's meant to grow and raise diplomats. And he was in the semifinals for that. Thank you for having me to you up next.
Hello. Keeping with the groove of things, I'll introduce myself. My name is Hugh Barner, as you may or may not recall. Happy Valentine's Day.
Yeah,
the season of love. But love isn't the only thing in the air. It's peak scholarship season. Application season and POG, or Portrait of a Graduate Team, has reported that students at RCHS have surpassed the FAFSA, or free application for student aid goal, set in place, reaching 102% of the desired goal with more in progress. The next thing I will talk about is the Skills USA competition. Cassidy Graves, Austin Clem, and Scott Woodward went to the Skills USA competition in Loudoun County, where they competed in three categories, including arc welding, MIG welding, and oxy fuel torch cutting. They had a total of 4 hours to complete these projects. Another excursion that took place was at the end of January. Mr. Jeffrey Day's dual enrollment U.S. government students competed in Charlottesville in the We the People State competition. They gave testimony and answered questions from panels of community members and about constitutional rights. Earlier this February, the Art Club went on a field trip to Florida, where they participated in Disney Festival of Arts at Epcot. They also visited the Ringling College of Art and Design, as well as the Ringling Museum of Art. And last but not least for tonight, the RCHS Leo Club made 17 blankets within 2 hours of their January meeting. These blankets were then donated to Project Lions, an organization whose mission is to provide blankets to youth in need. This initiative was spearheaded by Alexis Amy, one of the RCHS Leo Club secretaries. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. It's good to hear from you. Good job. Good to see you all. And look, if you need to go home and do homework, you're free to do that. We will not judge you. But you're welcome to stay. It's good to see you.
Thank you.
Thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
Thank you both. It's great. What are we going to do? What are we doing with this next agenda item?
Well, we've already given the board members some appreciation gifts. Now, these are also from the students and both schools. BSBA is School Board Appreciation Month, but it's also Valentine's Day. And we would be remiss if we did not include our wonderful Board of Supervisors members as well. We really do appreciate the collaboration and all that you do for our county, and we appreciate your service. And so do our students and our teachers. So they've showered you with some love tonight, so I hope that's okay.
That's fine.
These are made These are amazing.
Yes.
And this one, this is hilarious. So, this is made from the picture of the five of us. So you can figure out who's who.
The third graders made it into the STEAM lab with a glowtorch. Third graders, and their depictions of our board members are just priceless, so you'll have to come look at them. Oh, the STEAM lab is the STEM with the arts, Mr. Curry. It's okay to add arts into the STEM. And this is part of what that does. So we use STEM technology and also integrate creativity in the arts in our STEAM lab. So.
How about these photographs?
The photographs are actually taken by Tim Stockdale with his drone technology at the high school, which students also use in photojournalism. And different courses that way, and we tried to get it as close as we could to your represented districts as well. And the school board members have drone photographs up there of the schools, of course, aerial footage of the schools. So.
That's wonderful.
Thank you.
It's good to feel appreciated. Once a year for a month. Whatever we can get. Tomorrow is back to the salt water. Okay. All right. This is you, Dr.
Okay, we're ready to move on to the meat of tonight. The budget building blocks presentation is a presentation we do each year to go through very early in the budget process those inputs and challenges that we may be facing so that we can talk about them right up front and maybe get some guidance from our boards and also hear from the public. This is also provided in paper form at the table over there, and I think all board members also have a copy, and it has been posted to board docs as well. All right, so budget development for FY24. At Rappahannock County Schools, we work really hard to align all of our objectives and, of course, how we build our budget around our vision and mission. Our vision, of course, is to empower every student to reach his or her full individual potential. And our mission is to promote a culture of learning, a roadmap for excellence, and the passion and character that leads to each student's success. The budget is the foundation of all of our goals, which are listed here, and they are also depicted in greater detail in our comprehensive plan, Road to Remarkable, that was voted on this past June and is the 5-year roadmap to everything that we're about and what are our overarching goals in each of the 7 priority areas. Those priority areas are content knowledge, career preparation and workplace skills, financial planning, community engagement and civic responsibility, recruitment and retention, and parent, family, and community involvement. And our entire comprehensive plan revolves around those priority areas, and many folks from the community and members of staff, parents, students helped design this plan. Key considerations are always what is going to happen in Richmond, right? Because we don't always know until very last minute, like what the case was last year. So the governor's budget started out with a 5% increase for compensation and for SOQ positions in both years of the biennium, year in year 2. That's 5% increase in FY23, and that was amended during the process to also add in a 1% bonus. 5% SOQ increase for the following year as well. Right now, we're looking at what the House and the Senate have put forth in their budgets, and it's looking like it will be amended for a 7% increase with a big push toward investing in the teaching profession right now with a shortage. Enrollment and ADM are always key indicators and something that we work to project so we know about how much revenue we will receive. Retaining, recruiting talented staff, critical and key to everything that we do. Maintaining the integrity of our effective programs that make us who we are. Capital improvement needs. This has been a huge priority area for the state, especially after the crumbling schools tour that the Byrne administration went on with the Coalition of Small Rural Schools, and really saw how much will need to be invested in school infrastructure. We are very pleased with the progress we've made and
there will be more about that later. And of course, any new state mandates that we have to watch for, because that can dictate whether or not it's funded, unfunded, underfunded, all those things. We gave a survey to, as we do every year, just to see what's on the minds of our community members. And that includes students, parents, employees, teachers, administration, and they can all respond and tell us what priority areas are most dear to them. Here you can see in FY23 what the planning priorities were from that survey. And then this year, not too much changed for the top four. Top four remain the same, maybe just in a slightly different order, followed by curriculum enrichment, school safety moved up on the list, STEM moved up on the list, field trips dropped down a little bit, instructional support, and then capital improvement, which actually wasn't on the top 10 list before, but it is now. I think people are seeing some of the upgrades and it's like, wow, that's pretty nice. The governor's budget, we had to initially try to get some cost projections for you based on that, because that's the only iterated budget we have at this point with a calculation tool. We'll talk about that too a little bit. but that composite index was re-benchmarked, if you remember, at a 0.8. And what that means is 80% of the cost of educating students in Rappahannock County comes from the locality. And less than 20% comes from the state or federal government. So everything we do, we have to be very careful and mindful of our taxpayers, as well as knowing what we need to do for students, which there's a lot of competing priorities for those limited tax dollars. Our total state revenue with the governor's budget projected in FY24 would add $325 over last year, this year rather, but kind of, that is only because that $1 million that was infused into FY23 as one-time capital dollars that we weren't sure we were going to get until late in June can only be used for capital improvement and must be allowed to roll over to the following year. Okay, so when we adjusted the difference of what we project to be rollover, carryover funds of those, that's what puts you at the 325. So in your instructional funding, you're still going to be looking at a little bit of a deficit depending on some of those factors, but capital pushed that overall revenue from the state up a little bit. This slide is just an example for you that comes out of our funding and staffing tool from the state. You're given a certain amount of funding for what's called SOQ, or Standards of Quality Positions. Those are staff that you must have according to state code in order to do business. Thing is, I can't really hire 1.24 elementary guidance counselors or 0.93 of a principal that rounds up a little, but that's the only amount that you would get funded for based on enrollment in the school. So that's a consideration too, is what do our enrollment, what does our enrollment look like and what does our staffing tool look like? We also have the support cap dilemma, which is still in place. There is some legislation we are hopeful will go through to help continually remove this support cap. But you also receive standards of quality funding for certain support positions. Now remember, we only get about 17% to fund what the state says we must have. And then there's also a cap on the support positions they also say you must have. So it's even more of an issue. So much so that since 2010, Rappahannock County has lost over $770,000 that could have been used for those positions the state says we must have. So that's a dilemma that we are fighting in Richmond to hopefully get that cap removed as well. Then we use a planning factor staffing tool worksheet to go through and plug in the required staffing amounts, how many staff that we have, and try to get an idea of how many, what do we look like over standards of quality. So that's just examples of what that looks like. But the analysis summary shows us that we're about 3 positions over what SOQ would say at the elementary and 1.7. So not too far off, and that's to be expected because we did build in extra support positions post-COVID using ESSER funds mainly to add those with the idea that they would absorb in through attrition anyway. Central office staffing, we're down to 9 FTE local funds and 2
FTE, full-time equivalents for grants, funded by grants. We have one executive director position that will be a retirement this year, and there is not a plan to replace that position, but rather continue to provide more direct support to instruction at the school level. So then we get into some scenarios for consideration. So the governor's budget, 5% increase, what does that cost on what we're planning for staffing in FY24? Around $297,000, because we only get a slight adjustment from the state. We have to make up the rest. If the 7% goes through, that's $492,000. And we are anticipating a 15% insurance increase, and that'll cost about a $213,000 if the board were to decide to hold employees harmless and try to hold the line with benefits. What we know happens when there's a state increase like this and there's an infusion of compensation money coming from the state, what happens in other localities that receive a whole lot more aid say, wow, okay, we got all of this for this 7%, now we can use additional tax revenue to give another 5 and get ahead of everybody. So that's where it gets really difficult for us. So maintaining a competitive benefits package, being the most remarkable school district we can be, really helps us to try to retain our staff, because it's very difficult to keep up, especially bordering some Northern Virginia schools. Here's just a look at the teacher salary benchmarks. We benchmark to the median at these different yearly marks every year. So we've fallen down a little bit, which usually happens with a bigger state adjustment. But we are working toward gaining some ground there, which we have. We've done a lot of work with salary compression on parts of the scale, so we could do more upfront for beginning teachers. So we're a lot better off than we were. But still, we'd like to get a little closer to the middle there. But so our rankings came down a bit in the first year and 15-year. Third year, we're at the same rank as we were before with a bachelor's degree level teacher. And master's degree, we held close to our 15 and 30 year, but then came down first year. A lot of that compensation adjustment money pushed everyone else up to that first year. So more work to do there. Enrollment and average daily membership. FY23, we were at 725. We're looking at, might come in around there. We're projecting FY24, 715 for our ADM, so it continues to move downward. Although, what I'm reading about the toddler population around Rappahannock County is really promising, so hopefully those numbers will come back up. However, that's different than your K-12 enrollment and your pre-K-12 enrollment. All of those students are still enrolled at 741 students currently this year, pre-K through 12, which means we still are responsible for these students, but we are only going to receive funding for 725, even though that's how many we're serving currently in the building. This is chart just kind of shows you the history of the county contribution to schools. Sorry, my Zoom is acting funny. And then this slide was done by Mr. Curry before as an analysis to look at the contribution and expenditures per student over time. And we've actually not gone up very much, even since 2011, on how much this county does spend on educating youth as far as the ratio. Excuse me, sorry. I didn't have anybody on Zoom before, so hopefully it didn't knock anybody off. Okay, and those are our current budget building blocks as we see them right now. Mr. Curry?
So does the board want to pause and ask any questions of Dr. Grinsley? Would like kind of staff to work through high-level budget drivers on our side first? Right, so my part of this presentation is very easy. Hopefully you've all had an opportunity to meet Bonnie Jewell, our new assistant county administrator. She is going to lead us through a short presentation to put together at this early stage for the county budget.
Yes, and with that, I'll reiterate, we are still very early in the building of the county's budget. We are still every day getting inputs from different departments and regional partners for our budget. But in terms of big significant budget inputs, there's a general consensus among economists that we should expect a mild recession in 2023. And that's really being driven by the Federal Reserve's increasing of interest rates to try to temper the inflation. The state, as it developed its budget, is forecasting a recession to begin the second half of fiscal 23. So that's the first half of calendar year 23. And they expect that recession, the mild recession, to last about 3 quarters. So into the first half of fiscal 24. Locally, we are expecting our state, our local sales tax and yield and lodging tax revenue growth to lessen or level. And note that I said we're expecting the growth to lessen or level. We're not expecting the revenue to decrease, at least I'm not at this point, but the growth will lessen. In terms of real estate and personal property, we are still awaiting forthcoming data from the Commissioner of Revenue as to those assessed values. But we do know from looking around the county that there is new construction, and so there will be values associated with those new construction, with that new construction. We also know from trends from other entities that used vehicle prices have moderated during 2022 and are continuing to do so into 2023. Dr. Grinsley, could you click that arrow in the bottom right? There we go. Thank you. You're welcome. So this graph is a graph from J.P. Morgan Research in a November 22 article that they did. So the data is a little bit dated, but I think it still is going to show you a trend. There's a red dot there on the far right-hand side. It's very difficult to see from this distance. That reflects the uppermost point of that trend in January of 2022. And of course, our assessed values for taxation purposes are based on the January values. The highest point on that graph was January 2022. Since then, each month, the values have dropped off and are continuing to do so into 2023. And so we expect the assessed value of used vehicles, which are the majority of our vehicles in the county, to drop off as well. Dr. Grimsley, could you click that arrow? Thank you. So returning back to the slides here, when the assessed value increased in 2022, the tax rate for personal property was equalized down. With decreasing values occurring in 2023, the rate will need to be equalized upwards if revenue is to be maintained at the same budgeted level for fiscal 24. As Dr. Grimsley noted, the state's adopted budget included a 5% increase to base salaries for state-supported positions. And in the county's budget, those state-supported positions are the constitutional officers and their staff, a portion of their staff, as well as the Department of Social Services and that staff. That 5% increase is effective July 1, but as Dr. Grimsley noted, both the House and the Senate budgets include a 2% increase above that 5% for a total of 7%. So in the county's budget, each 1% in the general fund, and just note that the general fund does not include social services, each 1% in the general fund is estimated to cost an additional $42,000 in expenses that will be offset by an additional $11,000 in state revenue. So the net tax support for each additional 1% in the general fund is $31,000. You'll recall that the fiscal 23 budget included a $150,000 placeholder for a compensation study and the implementation of that of the outcome from that study. We expect that placeholder to remain in the fiscal 24 base budget, and as a result of the state increase, are planning for a 7% increase to that placeholder at this time. Since this is year two of the state's biennial budget, there is no change in the VRS retirement rate or the VRS life insurance rate. we have not received yet from the county's insurer the premium change amounts for fiscal 24, but are expecting that information to arrive in the next week or so. We do anticipate an increase in that cost, and at this point are anticipating sharing that with employees who participate in the plan. We're assuming that the existing cost share that's in place will remain in place, that the method, unless otherwise directed by the board, and that method is 100% coverage for employee-only coverage, and then cost sharing the incremental costs for dependent coverage. Just like all of our personal budgets, inflation will factor into the county's operating budget for fiscal 24. Increases are expected in contracted costs like IT costs, insurance, supplies, equipment, and utilities budgets. Of course, also a significant input to the county's budget is the school's budget request, and we acknowledge that. And then the last significant category of budget inputs is fire and rescue at this point. If the board were to continue, were to include continuation of the Sperryville rescue staffing through fiscal 24 at 3 days a week, 24 hours a day for the full year at $30 an hour. 80% of that cost will be funded by the county, 20% is assumed by Sperryville Rescue, and at about 105% for any contingency needs. That's about $95,000 added cost to the fiscal 24 budget. Additionally, we have received from our fire rescue, emergency services coordinator, budget requests that include a recruitment and retention coordinator, incentives to attract and retain active call running volunteers, and then capital expenses such as purchase of a ventilator, installation of fire protection between the living and office spaces, and apparatus bays at stations, installation of exhaust recovery systems in the bays at the stations, and then turnout gear extractors, which are basically very large washers and dryers for turnout gear. And so with all of these things, we need to determine what the revenue source will be. What types of things should we be looking at? Increase of the fire levy for the fire-related costs, fire and rescue-related costs. Is this the year that we consider a cigarette tax? And thank you. And on the slide here, this is the northern portion of the state, all the different counties. And those counties that currently have a cigarette tax in place are highlighted in green. You see there in the middle is Culpeper, Rappahannock. Those are white because we don't have a cigarette tax in place at this point. And then Warren County and Frederick County are outlined in blue. We have heard from Warren County that they are definitely intending to bring up the conversation of the cigarette tax again as part of their fiscal 24 budget process, and heard from Warren County that Frederick County is also intending to do the same as part of the fiscal 24 budget process. So if it's impossible to see this on that slide, but if you're looking at the slide in front of you, we have included for each of the green shaded counties the tax rates that are in place for your reference. And then the last slide I have for the county budget, really for the county-wide budget to include the schools, is the budget schedule, and you can see there the upcoming meetings. Thank you.
Any questions for us about what
Billy
wants this time?
Sure. Dr. Brinkley, we talked about this recently, but I just wonder if you could, in terms of recruitment and retention of teachers in particular, I guess my first question is when instructors come into the system for a while, what are their primary reasons or primary reason? Is it entirely driven by salaries? And then also, I wonder if you could just speak to the specific measures that you engage in on normally to enhance recruitment and retention efforts, and what you're not doing that you might be thinking about doing in the near future so that we can keep our staff intact?
Certainly. Thank you for the question. So when we do have some turnover, generally retirement is our biggest reason, but when they leave for somewhere else, generally for a couple of reasons. Salary is a big one, but we lose them, especially in Northern Virginia schools. And also more room to be more versatile. We have a pretty few in each department, few slots for certain teachers. So if you're multi-endorsed, that really does help you. But it's tough sometimes to not have a whole department of colleagues in that same, you know, we don't have five teachers that teach ninth grade English. For reasons like that, or climbing up the ladder. We don't have a lot of positions for climbing up the ladder. So that's a reason why, initially, when we reviewed that data, that we put in the teacher leadership program, grant funded, where we provide additional leadership opportunities for staff with additional compensation tied to that for different coordination activities. It might be to lead curriculum development. Might be a whole different reasons why, but those come from the teachers themselves. The teacher leadership come up with the areas where leadership is maybe needed, areas that administration could address differently with the help of some of those in the field. So that's one way. And then the other way, because we don't receive a lot of funding for professional development and quality instruction for teaching, that comes from our Title II federal funds. And we only get about $23,000 for that to professionally develop all of our staff, which one good adoption of a program, coaching, and we'll eat that up really quickly, just one. So that kind of gives you an idea of what it costs to really train and coach staffing, especially when we're talking about things like literacy training and the Orton Gillingham approach that we're working on in the Virginia Literacy Act coming down the pike. That's really top of your mind right now. So that's one way, and then also we go out and try to write as many grants as possible for that priority area, and that's where we'll talk a little bit more in the SIFT team, where the Panther Team 3 really identified that, our school's finance, innovative finance task force, identified that area as one of the highest priorities where it's not really funded, but a great need to keep our high quality staff.
And then I just had one more question. I think it's correct that the retirement in the front office would be a non-SOQ position. Is that right?
The retirement in the central office?
The pending retirement in the head office, is that not an SOQ?
It's an SOQ partially support position because it's about six of them in one.
I've seen.
When you do that with the support portion, it almost adds up to a full FTE of a required SOQ. As long as we can show in our job descriptions and duties that we're meeting that need, we can have some flexibility in support positions.
And did I hear you correctly that you're not intending to fill again that position?
In that same sense, yes.
Okay, and then my final question is, obviously you're freeing up salary money, and then looking through the lens of the drop in your starting salaries for teachers, particularly at the master's degree level, and that the most junior folks come in with a master's degree, it looks like we rank last. And I just wonder, when you have retirements like the one you talked about, to what extent can you use those freed up salary funds to bolster starting salaries for our teachers?
Right, and that, because it's scale based, it's going to affect the entire line. So the cost comes with each person on that scale. So you impact one part of the scale, it'll be a domino effect for the rest. So it does get pretty costly every adjustment you make to each part of that scale. But in our recruiting efforts, we've been launching a whole lot more outreach about all the other benefits too. So, yeah, maybe on paper our starting salary isn't the greatest, but we do have pretty good health insurance. We do better in tuition reimbursement than anyone around. We have all these programs that we do a lot with morale. We support our teachers in getting furthering their education, degree programs, and offer quite a lot with travel and conference and collegial pay that way. So those are the things we talk about quite a bit when we go recruiting. Yeah. And it seems to matter a lot to teachers.
Who would want to live in Rappahannock County anyway?
Exactly. Yeah. Look at this place. We show them pictures and then they're booked.
That's great. Thanks a lot.
The 15% insurance, that seems higher than I've heard in a while.
Yes.
Do you have any idea why you're expecting that level of a change?
We're hoping that the health insurance rate is not 15%. However, in analyzing our claims, it was coming at last year, 10.5% last year. And when we benchmarked it in November, we had already exceeded that. The amount of claims we had at that point in the year, the previous year. So all indications point to another large claims pool. Even though we are in the local choice, which does protect us from a huge balloon increase, like some other districts saw, over 30%. So hopefully, you know, that will stabilize a little. We're just trying to make sure we plan for the worst, hope for the best. but yeah, our claims data is showing that it'll likely be another hefty increase.
I know there for a couple of years anyway, you didn't have any increase, and now it's unheard of, so it's like catching up with you.
Yes, so the question was, we haven't had increases for about six years or so, and then last year was our first one in a while. In fact, the two previous years we saw a decrease. A lot of emphasis on health and wellness in this district. Of course, Commit to Be Fit, and give you a nice little gift so you can kind of see what we emphasize here too. But the last 2 years we're looking at anticipating that increase. And we have been talking probably the last three or four about a strategy should that happen. So there's been a lot of attention toward looking at having a high deductible plan and incentivizing that with an HSA. And we've been doing a lot more education with our staff around that premise and having different scenarios for our school board to consider as part of the compensation package when we really do see kind of how it all comes together and what the actual cost would be.
The only thing else I have on the community survey priorities, substantial jump in school safety concerns.
Mm-hmm.
I know you all do different scenario planning and that kind of thing. Do you have any, is it just because of what people are hearing in the news that you think that the parents are getting more concerned? Or
I imagine it's at the top of everyone's mind a lot with recent things you see in the media and the tragedies happening, of course. And school safety has always been a major priority of ours anyway. Each year we emphasize it at the start of every year with our staff, go through a very extensive and difficult training. But I would say again, we're probably much more prepared than most with crisis management. So we feel really confident about that. There's always more we can do, but we've expanded it every year. Branching out to our EMS coordinator, working through an audit that way, working with our sheriff's office. Just recently, we went through another training and audit. Dr. Robin Bolt and Mike Tupper and our EMS service coordinator worked through some reunification procedures and how we're going to manage a crisis situation every step of the way. So we keep it on as a running agenda item that we consistently keep up.
Thank you. Hope you never need it.
Me too.
Question. It's somewhat related to the budget, but not so much this presentation. But as you know, because you actually commented on it on the social media, that there's some kickback on this program. The school has this JEDI program, but they get a different name for it now, or it's called the transitional name. The Justice.
Equity, Diversity, Inclusion.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So if your question about it, it's not a program. What that is just a committee around the concept of equity that started about 6 years ago. And that committee really looks at any barriers to advise administration or have activities around if there are access barriers. So that's what that committee is designed to do. Is there any barriers to learning in different subpopulations of our student body? Is there anything in policy that might inhibit students getting equal access to those programs? And then recently this year, JEDI team brought guest speakers for each of our Heritage Months. So that's been a way just to enrich cultural competence. And they all have Rappahannock ties, which has been making it community-centered. So that's been the goal of JEDI team. But it's not a program or it doesn't have a curriculum tied to it. It's a team consisting of teachers, staff, community members, students that all look at these things that are important to them, and is there anything stopping or any barriers from us learning the way we should be learning? And right now, poverty has been the number one barrier that we've identified, no matter the background of any student. So if we look at policy through an equity lens, what we're talking about is the barriers identified impeding any of the programs that were any of our goals.
It is considered a school too.
Yes.
And some of the complaints I've gotten with phone calls and, you know, stopping me on the street type of thing, is that this, an upcoming event, I believe it is being held at a location that's not part of the school activities, that normally considered. And as a matter of fact, it's a place where some people may not feel comfortable because of the activities that the owners involved in, and like, you know, political activities type of thing. But anyways, it's also a place where they sell alcohol off premise, you know, because some say are really on premise. So it's not really a, considered by some parents a convenient location to have a school type center program. But
no,
I was wondering about that. I don't have prepared notes, and I'm just trying to remember what people have complained about.
No, I appreciate you sharing the concerns, and the guest speakers coming are the Kilby cousins, who authored a book, and they have both have Rappahannock ties, and it ties into Black History Month theme. They are speaking at each of the schools around the SOL concepts that students need to learn during Black History Month. Now, they did need to eat lunch, so the part of a meet and greet off-site was really a function of finding a place that was open during that time so that they could eat, and also open it up if anyone wanted to meet them. So that's a community meet and greet. It's not part of the schools. We don't have students going there or anything. The speakers are coming to the schools, one at the elementary and then one at the high school before and after that.
Yes. Perhaps that's not the way that it was conveyed in the paper, but we didn't have all that information.
Okay, I'm sorry about that, but that's something we can bring up with the team.
Thank you.
Absolutely, you're welcome.
Capital improvements,
okay. Well, this was identified as in most work sessions as an area of concern because capital improvements can cost a lot of money. But I think as you've seen in our budget development over the last couple of years, we haven't raised the budget much for that. And in fact, we even took out the amount that was being earmarked in PAYGO funds for school capital improvement because we were able to get additional money from the state. So Dr. Bolt, I'm gonna ask you to come up to give a facilities update.
Hello. So we've really been hitting capital most of the time. For the last 5 years. And so rather than stand here and worry with my monotone voice, I created a video that will highlight what we've done and for the last 5 years, including this year, and what we're doing next year. So.
Take it 8:15 into the
The library, and then the third and through seventh grade, all the HVAC systems will be updated. And then we're completing 24 classrooms, so the original 1959 classrooms will evolve and we'll get to that one. That happens in summer.
Okay. And then?
And the culinary room. And the courtyard. That happens.
That's right. And then to kind of be on this projection that you showed here, what else is on the horizon? After you've condensed effort and every all business has been taken care of, what's next?
What's next? Then we move on to finishing the rest of the bathrooms.
Okay.
And then moving down to the primary wing. We got the public, so it's time for an update there. And then down the eighth grade wing.
Okay. And is that 3 years now?
Well, we're going to start next year. And but next year we're doing, because I do everything in the summer, so when I say next year, so then I'll start planning the next summer, which will be the moving out. And then in the back of our mind, we're keeping the sewer treatment plant at the high school. I spoke with Pamela Parker last week, and it's looking like it's going to be 5 years out before they come up with what the fluid's going to have to be, so we have no way to judge what we'll need to do, but it's always on the capital.
Okay, and then last question, my current pet project, ADD units, and we're talking from a county perspective about a program to deploy them in more public locations, and I just wonder if you could just summarize what you have in place currently and what you might need to.
We have some in every building. We have the library, the nurse has one, we have one in the gym, we have one in the eighth grade wing. We actually just did stop the bleed training last Friday, and we're bringing the stop the bleed kits right by the AED kits, so that we have the available in our county and in school.
Okay. Yeah, as we work out from a county perspective, I think we should work together so that if there's an opportunity to kind of track all of these AEDs that are deployed, maintaining them would be smart.
Well, and none of this is possible without the community, the board of supervisors, the school board working together. If you look at several of those projects, we're community efforts.
Yeah.
And Rappahannock, in my opinion, is unique that everyone comes together for an archery, which is pretty awesome. It doesn't happen.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much for our presentation.
I have one good question. I was just interested to hear about the renovation of the library at the high school. Is it a cosmetic renovation? Is there other stuff going on technologically?
Well, the HVAC has already been done. It's cosmetic. The last picture that you saw was the model of what it's going to look like. We are actually putting a language space there off the side of it, and we're incorporating the courtyard into that. There'll be charging stations for the students. There will be lounge areas with built-in charge stations. It was a pretty quick picture, but we're putting, within our library, and there's that pillar, we're doing a glass wall, so that one section can be for collaboration. So there'll be monitors where they can just cast their devices and so they can work together. So there is a focus on technology. And what we did, it's been a two-year process now. We started with students to see what they wanted in the library. And from there, we got community members and teachers and students elected a rep to be on our committee to look at the furniture and figure out what exactly was needed.
Thank you.
Can we get a copy of that video if we want to watch it?
Well, and a lot's been done, and you know, I'm the one who's, I'm the project manager, but it's the people, the custodians, and the people in the buildings that are the vendors we have coming to making that happen. So we've been very lucky.
Dr. Hall does a very, very good job about keeping everything updated with the schedule when it has to be replaced. So, you know, don't forbid something happen or she wants to leave us or anything like that. You can't do that. You know, somebody can pick up and see what the schedule looks like for some of those bigger projects. And she's done a great job really working to get so much done so quickly. And everyone that walks into this school, the school buildings that have graduated here, came back, cannot believe it's the same school. So, great job, Ron.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Dr. Grimsley, can you speak to the capital funding coming out of the state? Not a million, mm-hmm. but I think it's $200,000 a year. Do you view that as sustainable into the future? Of course, we don't know what the General Assembly is going to do. But.
Absolutely. So, the infrastructure modernization funds, we get $200,000 per year for those infrastructure items. That looks like to be sustainable in every budget that I've looked at and each of the priority areas of each chamber too. So I don't think anyone's going to pull away any capital improvement money from schools for that, especially after, like I said, the crumbling schools tour and all the lobbying that went on for additional dollars, especially for rural schools. So we were able to receive additional funding that way too.
And we're fortunate that that doesn't pass. That has a floor of $200,000, so our LCI isn't really a penalty there for us. Because we're small, we still get the $200,000. It's not 17%, 20%.
Yeah, it would have been about $26,000, I think, when it funneled through LCI if they didn't put that floor. So that's been another area of advocacy that we've tried to deploy when we speak with legislators. Please put those floors in when you consider adding up a lot of funding that you want to have at the impact. Any other capital improvement questions? Okay. Moving on, School Innovative Finance Task Force update. This was actually an outgrowth from a conversation that really happened at one of these meetings. So the collaboration did come in very handy with these conversations around the challenges of school funding. Headwaters did a community conversation, a three-part series, bringing community around. What is going on with the school funding? Why does it cost so much? And why, you know, with a declining population? All these questions were coming up, and we needed to really educate the community about these things because it is complex, and understanding local composite index and our tax structure and what ADM means and all these different things. But then in one of these meetings it came up, you know, now that we've identified some areas, Ms. Smith said, you know, we should really have a combined task force and bring the community and the boards together and the administration around this
concept and see what solutions we can come up with. So that's when School Innovative Finance Task Force began. And that was the county administrator, Mr. Curry, and myself, and the chairs of both boards around Panther teams to look at three specific areas where we thought we could maybe have some impact or could do some fact finding. And that was the local composite index, the state budget, and philanthropic opportunities. So the Panther team won. Mr. Curry, I didn't know if you wanted to speak to that, or Mr. Mills, since you both chaired that committee together.
Well, we spent months, it was 3 months, analyzing the group of citizens competent in this area, studying what, as a community, we would need to do to have an impact on our 0.8 LCI rating. And our conclusion was, can't move a large stone. That was an immovable object at that point because the way the parameters were against us based on our numbers, you probably better speak to that.
Well, and I think also that we wouldn't appreciate a community that shifted those metrics in a way that meaningfully changed the LCI. Things that make Rappahannock County unique are also those things that lead to a very high LCI. And so, you know, it's very important to us, our uniqueness and the values we have in this community. So that means you'd have to change the formula, which people have attempted that for a long time and gotten nowhere. And so we were pretty confident that that was likely not the avenue for a quick gain, or find other ways. And so the committee, through analyzing the formulas and the variables to the formula, look for ways that we could at least make some improvement. I think we've got Dr. Grimsley's put those on the screen. Conversations regarding land use taxation. Dr. Grimsley and I have had an opportunity to speak with Jay Lark on a study they're working on, will be released, I think, next year, and explaining to them how these variables impact us in a small community, and that land use taxation. Well, we tax citizens based on the reduced value of their property. The state values it at the full value when it goes into the LCI formula. We've asked for a number of years for that to change, and there's been resistance because LCI is a zero-sum game, and if we get more money, somebody else gets less money. So that's a tricky one. We also understood that the denominator in the LCI formula is ADM and population. So our population is pretty stable, but ADM has been dropping. And so we know that as the denominator goes down, that's going to influence your LCI to go up. So if our ADM goes down, it makes it even harder for us to push the LCI lower than that maximum 0.8.
And it did help us. We did reinvigorate the idea of partial ADM.
Exactly.
So there, it did promote that idea. And basically, what's happening is we pay a lot of attention to, you know, if we can get 10 students that are here part time, that does accumulate and give us a full time an ADM.
So partnering with the homeschool community or the private school community, take one class. Are there unique opportunities for those communities here at the school so we can pick up a quarter of an ADM or a half of an ADM here and there, and that helps in the long run.
And we're welcoming that type of involvement from the community, private and also.
And then ultimately, as it leads to, I think, Panther Team 2, is this formula is just stacked against us. And so if we can show that the math is stacked against us, we at least can use that in aligning efforts when we're asking for other changes, which was all about the state budget, which is all about the Panther Team 2.
Thank you, Mr. Curry. Mr. Mills? I think that was a really big deal that we're selling themselves short a little bit, is that the research and analytics that team employed got the attention of J-Bar
to come and speak to them and say, hey, so here you have some tools that you put together, some sensitivity analyses around this area and how it impacts. You can speak to this. So spent, I want to say it was 3 hours with us that day going through all of those items. And that study has been delayed a bit to the General Assembly. They did speak a little bit to standards of quality positions and funding ratios. That's about as far as they've gone, but the LCI formula is a biggie. Nerds and losers. So Panther Team 2 was the state budget review team, and that's the one that I chair. And I see one of my partners, Steph Ritter, is here. Deb, she was on my team. And this one was really pulling apart the state budget, all components of the budget calculation tool, analyzing each of those lines, seeing if we saw any discrepancies in any district in the Commonwealth. So we did analyze all 132 districts and their budget tools and saw what holes we could find or anything that caught our attention. What immediately did catch our attention was that there were a few areas where school districts were receiving additional funding that were not in the budget calc tools for others. So some of that was the COCA funding or cost of competing adjustment funding that Rappahannock is not in this little L shape on a map, even though the counties all around us got that cost of competing adjustment as well. So that's an area that we noticed in the budget calc tools. Adding the floors, as Mr. Curry mentioned before, like the infrastructure modernization, really makes a huge impact on divisions with high LCIs and little ability to regain local revenue through taxation. But then what really popped out at us was the supplemental basic aid line, and we didn't realize that there were only two of us that actually used that subsidy in the entire state, and that act is so restrictive that only four ever could use it. So that came out of our analysis, and when we worked those numbers, that appeared to be our biggest low-hanging fruit that we could go for if we could get General Assembly action around changing some enactment language in 2008 General Assembly. So no problem, right? Yes, there was a lot of education around that. We invited Delegate Weber to come to the school and check out our Ag Academy and some of the things going on there. Some of you were able to come to that tour. Thank you very much for attending. But also to talk about this inequity in funding and supplemental basic aid, where the enactment language essentially puts a cap on just Rappahannock's amount based on fiscal year 2007. Does not apply to anybody else, just Rappahannock. The other county is Highland County that receives that supplemental basic aid. They are not subject to the cap. And even though they have far fewer students than Rappahannock does, they receive far greater funding in that same line than we do. So it appeared like one of those inequities that would make sense to the delegate, which it did. And he did craft House Bill 1443, which hit the floor in the House and went completely unopposed through that chamber in each committee and on the floor. So that bodes really well for that bill. It has now been kicked over to the other chamber and goes before the Senate Finance Committee tomorrow morning. So I'll be heading to Richmond early in the morning to this meeting to go speak on behalf of that bill. We had a group go out to Richmond last week. Thank you so much, ladies, for doing that and educating that committee in particular about what this does and why it's important. There is a lot of conversation around funding rural public schools and filling the gap that happened with the budget calculation tool, which thankfully our LCI kind of protected us from a full impact of that. But it looks as though funding schools is a priority in that chamber right now. So the timing could not be more perfect. I'm optimistic that that should go through the Senate Finance Committee tomorrow. So make any phone calls if you know anyone on that committee. And then Panther Team 3 was our philanthropic opportunities. Here we do have a lot of wonderful foundations in the community. We have the PATH Foundation that's been really generous and funds many programs in the schools. So looking at the possibility of promoting mini campaigns for some of these things that we have that are unique to Rappahannock, our Ag Academy, Health Science Academy, Fine Arts, and maybe looking for additional funding to support those, because some of the pieces of our academy model may not be SOQ funded, even though we know they are so important to what we do, what makes us us. So looking for those and establishing protocols to ensure that private funds, this is something that donors say a lot, and when you write grants, that if we give you funds for recruitment and retention as a priority, and this is why that was identified as a priority, we don't want that to be a substitute for what is the basic responsibility of the locality in standards of quality, which it wouldn't be able to do that the way the tool is set up, but that was a concern too. So since Panther Team 3, an update there, a new source of dedicated funds has been identified to align with Road to Remarkable Priority 5, recruitment and retention, to help us on those things that are very important, staff morale, professional development, furthering your degrees, conferences, those pieces that small rural schools just can't do. They just don't have the money to do that high quality professional development and some of the things you see in bigger districts with that kind of a budget. So that's been very helpful. Progress is being made on establishing secure grant funding for this program, hopefully over the next 3 years. And additional grant writing efforts have taken place to secure funding around initiatives like mental health, our wellness center, driver's education, which we're getting ready to start our first group in 2 weeks, academies and fine arts, summer programs, capital improvements. So any chance we get, if we see a grant, we are going after it, if it aligns with our Road to Remarkable. Major accomplishments are on a summary slide at the end. So again, JLARC LCI study, being part, having a seat at that table and using Rappahannock data was huge. House Bill 1443, if that passes the Senate Finance Committee and goes all the way through, is signed and enacted, that will bring in an additional almost $1 million in state funding for instruction, standards of quality, and basic aid.
In perpetuity?
Yes. So that's a biggie for an input for us. So hopefully tomorrow I have some great news to send back to everybody. Teacher wellness, the best in class grants have been instrumental, especially during COVID and after COVID, of improving our retention efforts, boosting morale, building up any deficits in teaching ability or building capacity to deal with some of the added challenges we've seen post-COVID. It takes a lot more of a skill set than maybe even our most veteran teachers might be used to with some of the effects that we've seen. So it's, but we haven't skipped a beat, and we are working very hard on continuing to have high quality professional development for all of our staff. And so far, because of Panther Team 3 raising awareness, we've had over $817,000 over the last 3 years in philanthropic dollars toward those programs. So some huge impacts from our SIP team. So thank you so much for that collaboration. Any questions, final thoughts from SIP members?
Are these community meetings still ongoing? Or what's the status of this program?
So for SIP, we, Mr. Mills, I think you're the one that introduced Panther teams, like FBI Tiger teams.
No, so. Are the Panther teams all going? No, because we realize we can't get volunteers to volunteer for a team that doesn't have a beginning and an end.
Right.
That was the goal, to get people involved. They would commit to 3 months, but not to something that has no end. Yeah. And what our thought was, if we see the need for another Panther team, we create it. Mm-hmm. If it comes Team 4, Team 5, or we can reinvigorate previous team if we need to, if we see any targets or we need research, then, which our community stepped up to do the last time.
Mm-hmm.
SIP lives on.
Yes.
So SIP lives, the teams are quiet, but Team 2's $1 million chairman over there has been very busy, and this is the most fruitful that I can see that it's come from SIP. Although all of it was good, this is definitely was the, it's going to be very key for this particular budget year and ongoing.
The thing that I love about the SIP effort, and I so appreciate staff and leaders and the community that came forward volunteer is before that effort, we had a lot of unknowns. We would sort of sit down and discuss the budget every year and wish we could know all of these things. But now that we've had the experience through the SIP teams of working through those three main points, it's really informed me a lot in my job as a supervisor and being able to answer questions and knowing that we've really turned over every stone. And I appreciate all the work that you and your staff and county staff and people of Rappahannock County put into that effort. Thank you.
When the question came up about do we have a lobbyist that can help us in Richmond, it really seemed to me that you already had that under control. And I think that was through, was that through Postmarks or somebody else that was?
So we've had members attend most of these committee meetings through COSARS, Coalition of Small and Rural Schools, put in some support. Tom Smith is our legal liaison with the Virginia Association of School Superintendents, who has gone to these meetings and spoken in support. Unfortunately, he won't be there tomorrow morning because he has to be in another high priority BAS area. However, I am a board of directors on BAS, so I can also give support for BAS. So I will be there speaking as a superintendent for Rappahannock, but also on behalf of BAS for that.
Time well spent.
We'll see. It's worth it.
All right. Anything else on SIP?
I'll just add that I have the pleasure of attending with going to the Senate. We went to about a dozen offices in about 3 hours and got to speak with a lot of legislative aides. And every office runs differently, which is really interesting to see. There's in a standard way, but they were. For one thing, that it just shows that the little bit of sort of personal touch that you can give to this very, very minute part of a state budget, and I think that they really did see how much it meant to us, and I just really appreciate the people who are not, who were on this Norman Panther team were organizing this trip, and I was able to come along, and it was really nice to have a chance to just to put Rappahannock and people here all around the state. And I'm so excited that you're going to get to go. We're bragging about our superintendent to everybody. So we're going to head there tomorrow. But it's really interesting to see people come together at a time where we seem quite divided and our legislature is divided by a different part of control. But it's just gratifying to see 100%, you know, both parties had to vote for it in the House, and that happened. And then in the Senate, going to the people who are in control there, and they are supportive. They don't ask who we voted for or anything like that. They just are wanting to take care of our community, so I appreciate that.
It's a good trip.
Yes.
Good. How many of you got to go?
There were four of us.
Four, great. Great. The team.
Yeah, it took less time than we thought it would
take. That sounds like a busy day.
It was a busy day, yeah. It was worthwhile.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
What do you want to do? Public comment? Great. At this time, we'll open public comment. Anyone wishing to speak, if you would please be recognized, come up to the podium, let us know who you are, what district you're in. We'd appreciate that.
I am Steph Ritter, and I'm going to talk to you I'm so glad you're going down, because we promised a number of senators that we had this great superintendent who would be coming to the committee to speak. So I'm really glad you're doing that. I have three things that I want to say. First of all, we have a superb superintendent of public schools here. And I hope that you provide her with everything she needs through the budget and in every other way. And the other thing I want to say is, you know, I feel like I've been living and dreaming about HB 1443 for months. But I wanted to say that it is really amazing that we're getting a bill through that only affects one tiny county that most people, even in the legislature, have never heard of. They always say, oh, it's Rappahannock. No, it's Rappahannock. So, and it really took a community. And you can't imagine the number of people that have contributed to getting this piece of legislation passed. But I really want to thank Debbie Donahue for going and getting Delegate Greenberg on board, telling him how to write the legislation. Shannon, who's done just a superb job of shepherding this thing through, and Eve Brooks, who actually discovered what the fix was by talking to Eileen Fillercombe, and it was really to take a cap off. It had been placed in 2008. So, you know, when we get this $1 million, we're all going to have a party. And I just also wanted to thank the school board, the school administration, and Dr. Bolt for bringing the Kilby cousins to the high school, because giving the kids and their students a chance to hear from two people whose experience is both similar and really dissimilar because of the circumstances of their birth, I think is an invaluable education, especially for people who are basically local people. And I don't know how you can't replicate that in a classroom. So thank you all for doing that. I think it's a tremendous opportunity for the students. And then, third day is have a wonderful Valentine's. Thank you all for your service. I really know how tough it is. You've been great. Thank you, Debbie. It is amazing to me. I'm still just in awe of the fact that we're going to get a bill passed for
fingers crossed.
No jinxing. Anyone else have a comment? Don't have anyone on Zoom. Okay. I'll go ahead and close public comment. And next we have Board Supervisor comments. From the team?
Yes, since we're all here, one of the things that I wonder about and that I hear from folks about is throughout the pandemic, I know that created a lot of challenges in educational environments and set some students back in their goals and maybe where they should be in school. And I know Rappahannock has fared better than a lot of school systems in this regard. And I was just wondering if you had any updates for us on that.
We were monitoring student achievement data very carefully coming out of COVID to really get a new baseline, because it did impact every single person everywhere globally. Education was hit especially hard with a lot of the mandates that we had to follow. There were extended quarantines, there were closures, there were remote versus in-person, there were stressors and traumas that happened. So all of these pieces create a school environment that shifts focus. So maybe the SOL score is not the most important thing at the time, but let's just get to survival mode and get these families through it and make sure they can eat and that they have access to a good education. And we're gonna make sure they feel connected to their community. So that shifted focus. We never lost focus of academics, because that is what we're here to do, is educate. And we did that to the best of our ability. In fact, it's pretty remarkable if you look at our spring test scores in literacy. Our elementary school fared better in every indicator group than they did in 2018-19, which is far over pre-pandemic in growth rates. So that's a pretty incredible number. So we are very, very proud of that new baseline. We didn't see the deficits that we thought we would, given all the challenges we had. So that was a breath of fresh air, but there's still a lot of work to do. Because we do want to build resiliency among our students, make sure they can succeed and be life ready when they graduate here and have every opportunity. But they were resilient and they are bouncing back. The student data looks great.
And there's been a whole lot of effort to put in additional student supports. I'm happy to say that we finally got into the Virginia Tier System of Supports system, which we've been applying to for about every year, for 8 years, and they finally accepted us. But the state has at their fingertips all of these materials and coaching and in-depth professional development that you can use, and the timing is perfect with launching the Virginia Literacy Act, which we are actually very excited about, with having individual plans for literacy growth for every student. I think that's really important, but it is a heavy lift and a lot of training. But luckily, we have already started all of that, and actually the program that we've adopted, Letters, Louisa Motes, who is like the rock star of reading and the English person in me just loves her. But anyway, she leads the way in reading and literacy, and that's the program we were looking to adopt, and that's the one the state keeps saying is one of the best. So our teachers have already been being trained in letters, Orton Gillingham methods, phonetical awareness, and all of those pieces too. So we're ahead of the game with that implementation.
Thank you.
I would just like to say thank you for having us, and I am so excited to hear the news tomorrow morning about HB 1414. Hopefully, yeah. Knocking on my head. Thank you all so much for pulling that together and going in that direction. And like Ms. Ritter said, I think it's amazing that piece of legislation that's just about Rappahannock County has already had that much broad support in the House, which is really incredible. Thank you all so much for doing it.
I wanted to say thank you. And also, behind the wheel, when we find a problem in the schools, it seems to be resolved so quickly. And to find out that students weren't taking it because of the cost and not having a car in the county, I was shocked. But you've all jumped on it so quickly, and now you have a car, and classes are starting. And now businesses may actually have students that can drive to work, which isn't as big of a deal as it used to be for me. But it is a big deal for businesses in Rappahannock, because there's so many openings, and we need the youth to be able to come to work on time and not necessarily have to go with a parent, because I understand a lot of students are going to work with their parents working, so they don't, because they don't have the car or the ability. So thank you very much for jumping on that. And thank you for a wonderful evening. And all the goodies.
Thank you.
I think
before,
are you all? I think we're done.
So we have board comments. Are there any school board comments this evening? Before we... Anyone?
No.
We're good. Great job.
Yeah,
appreciate
you
coming.
I would like to say one more thing.
Go ahead, Larry.
I know Shannon talked about the academics and the test scores and so forth, but I think it's really important that everybody recognizes that that doesn't happen without really hard work from teachers, dedicated working every day. And I think that's just, it's vital that we spend every minute doing what we need to do to help kids. That's my 2 cents worth.
It's where the rubber meets the road.
Yeah.
Right?
Entertain a motion for adjournment for the Board of Supervisors?
So moved.
Second. All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you very much.
All right. So we're going to recess for 5 minutes.
Sure.
It's 8:01. So we'll recess for 5 minutes. We want to hear from our citizens. There's time for public comment. Prior to action items on the agenda, we ask the speakers identify themselves from the district. We also ask that your comments be limited to 3 minutes in order to provide equity all speakers, and to ensure our meeting is reasonable in length, give more information that can be summarized in 3 minutes. Please leave, provide leave behind materials for the board to review. Moderator will ask you to conclude your remarks as time has elapsed. If you have questions during the session, you may ask for clarification from your school board member or a school administrator after the meeting is adjourned. Thank you for coming and staying. Recognition of Clerk and Deputy Clerk Appreciation Week.
Yes.
What are we going to do this time?
So not only is it School Board Appreciation Month, but it's also Clerk Appreciation. So our Deputy Clerk, Michelle Burnick, cannot be here tonight. But we do have a little gift for her that we'll make sure that she does receive. But for AP,
oh my goodness,
you didn't know it.
No,
she has no idea. And I get it over here, so she didn't.
Oh my goodness!
It's surprise.
Oh,
so this is from the board and I. Little gift for you for everything that you do.
Oh, thank you.
It's a cat.
Did she cry?
Oh, I love it.
Pop here.
I love
you. Welcome. We love you.
Thank you.
I consider
thank
it.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
I consider
love it.
The appreciation years. Andy, I call and she's got my number memorized.
Yes, yes.
I'm a girl.
Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you for everything you do. Keeping us going and relating the show.
Yes, I
will. So sorry.
Yeah, no.
Hope she's healing up well.
Yeah.
I feel her pain.
Oh, yes, you do.
But, yeah, we are grateful for everything you guys do for us.
Oh, thank you very much.
Since we made a big deal out of you, could you review
yes.
the donations for us?
I sure can. Oh. Griffith Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling donated $1,000 to the junior class. Virginia Rise donated $500 for basketballs for RCHS athletics. Excuse me. Bandry Consulting donated $1,000 for the baseball team at the high school. Bandry Consulting donated $1,000 for sound equipment for the drama club. And Virginia Pates donated $100 for a ski club donation. And the after prom party donations are Blu-ray Caverns, 2 admission tickets, Country Chevrolet, $1,000, Luray Copy Services, $100, Glen Hill United Methodist Church, $100, Sherry Woodard Realty, $150, Penn Druid, $25, Holtzman Oil and Propane, $100, Blue Rock donated a $100 gift card.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
It's just amazing.
What
is my mind?
Oh,
I know.
You haven't gotten it yet, but Lyons donated $500 for the after prom.
Oh, okay.
Great.
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 Thank you for
reading
that.
Yes.
Do we have a motion to adopt the minutes from January 10th and 17th?
So moved.
We have a motion, Mr. Groves, or second?
Second.
Ms. Meyer, any comment? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. This will order. Mr. Grove, can you review the bills?
I did. I'm assuming that the retirement health line is going to be adjusted near the end of the year. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Everything else was
great. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
Wait, who is that? Was Mr. Uben? We have a motion, Mr. Uben. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Ms. Bama. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Dr. Grimsley, do you have any words left?
I don't need to because I'm going to call Dr. Johnson up to the podium to give you this one. I'll pass.
Good one.
Great. So thank you for the opportunity to talk to you about the 2023-24 proposed calendar for next year. I don't have anything really new or earth-shattering to offer as far as a calendar proposal. The requirements have remained the same, that we have either 180 school days or 990 hours. Rappahannock County Public Schools have 6.25 hours per day, which has resulted in an excess of hours beyond the 990 hours. Which results in the ability to use bank time for inclement weather days without actually having to make up those days. So the calendar committee met in January to discuss the priorities for the coming year as far as the calendar. The group agreed that we should continue with the early start to allow for the end of the first semester at the Christmas break, or excuse me, the winter break. The group also felt that it was important to continue with the current length of the winter break that we have in place. One issue that did come up this year was the idea of the half days that were built into the calendar. We added additional half days in last year in order for some additional professional development activities for our staff. However, we foresee this year the trend that student absences were increasing on those half days. So typically, on a regular school day between both schools, we would have around 44 absences. And on the half days that we had in the first semester, the absences ranged from 52 between both schools to a high of 179 absences, and that was in the month of November. So that really makes it difficult for teachers to provide continuity of instruction, as well as for us to be able to meet the state accreditation mandate for school attendance requirements. So we felt it was very important to take a look at those. There was consideration for the timing of conferences to be sure that those coincide around the time report cards go home. We want to give the students enough opportunity to be able to get on the ball after their parents come in and talk to the teacher. So we carefully place those in the upcoming calendar. And then having a full day for conferences versus a half day. And then allowing for the full PD day after the conference day by combining the half days that we were utilizing this year. Instead of using half days, just go ahead and put them together for a full PD day on the day after conferences. Our calendar committee was made up of staff members, and we had a parent rep. But then we also get the input of all of our staff and all of our families by posting two options for a calendar for everyone to have the opportunity to vote on. So in the two calendars that were presented this year, in order to include the PD days and the professional days, instead of having 180 days this year, we did, in making the calendar, have to drop back to 176 days. And believe me, that was very difficult for me because I'm a big rule follower, and you know, if you sell me 180, I go for 180. But the 176 days will more than amply allow us to reach the 990 required hours and still be able to utilize inclement weather days without having to make those up. So the first calendar, option one, had the two shorter spring breaks that we've become accustomed to over the course of the last couple of years. And then option two allowed for a week-long break that coincided in April to allow an opportunity for longer trips and things for families. So when we put those options out there, we did have the majority of the respondents voted for option one, which was the two shorter breaks. But as is the case every year, this vote is always really close. So we had 56% who were yes for option one, and then 44% who said no for option one. And then for option two, it was pretty much 50-50. So in looking through the comments sections on this, I don't know if you had a chance to look at those, the majority of the comments were related to the benefits of a longer spring break for families. Then the comments also reflected liking the two shorter spring breaks. There were several comments that revolved about placing the spring breaks around the Easter holiday, which I wasn't real sure what those were about because I didn't go back and double check, you know, those dates, and they matched up with what was in the current, you know, proposed calendars for the spring break. So, and then of course, we did pull back on the half days. That was, there was a lot of discussion about that on some of our calendar committee members, but the numbers pretty much directed us that that was something that needed to happen. So with that information, we had 100 respondents who weighed in on the calendar survey. So, you know, again, the options are really close for both calendars. And we would like to go ahead and recommend option one, since that did get, you know, a few more votes than the option two did. I did want to share one of the comments that came up, you know, even more recently, was the idea of shortening our winter break so that that could potentially give us a later start in the beginning of the school year. And so in considering that, you know, if we were to take a week off of the spring break, we could potentially start a week later at the beginning of the school year.
A week off of the winter break.
Yes. And so that would reduce the winter break quite a bit. Again, you know, I'm going with the recommendation of the calendar committee that we pulled together, that they felt like that winter break was important to keep in place for the coming school year. But of course, it's up to the discretion of the board. So we're going in and recommending option one, but the decision is ultimately up to you.
So the committee's recommending one.
Yes.
Most of these comments that are in the comments section favor number two.
Some of them are interesting questions. Like the last comment I see, is there a report showing where the greatest increase in staff absences are? Did you look at that?
Yes, I did see that comment in there as far as sites of employee absence. Unfortunately, that data is a little bit tricky to identify at this point in time, because the last couple of years we've had a lot of COVID-related absences.
Yes.
So there's not a way to get, I mean, I think that's definitely something to keep an eye on, you know, as we move forward. And then the other comment that was towards the end about having the Friday off before Labor Day, we do qualify for a waiver to that requirement based on our track record of inclement weather days that occur over a certain period of years. So,
do you have any comments or questions? I mean, looking at them, the only difference I can see when I talk between the two is the 1 week versus two short breaks in April, maybe, or March, April.
Two shorter breaks in the morning.
I can't hear you.
So I people I talk with prefer the two shorter breaks, but that's just remember.
What do you think? We need to vote.
Well, the recommendation is for one.
Yes, the recommendation is for one.
And yeah, I mean, it's basically it's 50-50. Yeah.
Basically, it's the same. I mean, I felt personally like two shorter breaks when I was speaking to break up that time from Christmas to spring.
That's
educational wise, right. Because the kids get to. End of March and nobody's doing anything.
You don't have
to put
down time.
Yeah. Right. But that's not what they voted on. So.
Hey, Bud, can you scooch up a little bit? So from a teacher's perspective,
from my
yours.
Perspective as a teacher,
right.
I liked the fall is fine because you got a little breaks in between and you have Christmas. But to get from Christmas, when we used to do Easter, and when Easter fell on the latter part of April,
it's a long run.
That's too long for kids in the elementary. I mean, I was in sixth and seventh grade, and they stopped doing things by the end of March. I mean, you were like pound and brick.
So the two breaks
spring break till the end of the school year was a
zoo.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, because they were finished.
From an administrator's point of view, you just ended the year in April.
So the two breaks facilitate.
To me, a winter break in the end, like now, like at the end of February, even if it was just a 4 days, like Friday, Monday, would be, to me, make sense.
Yeah, that's sort of like
But we do it by, we had a birthday here.
As far as the calendar committee, I really encourage the team to look at this through the educational lens of what's going to be in the best interest of student instruction. And when I look at the shorter break, I can make an argument for that because there's less time, in between where, for the students to get reacclimated, whereas, the timing of the week-long break may, be more appropriate to support learning in other ways. So, it's a toss-up either way I go if I look at it, even through that instructional lens.
The two shorter breaks would be more advantageous for special ed kids, English language kids, the less amount of time that they have to be out of school is a better deal, a better way to go from that.
Less disruption to their schedule.
Right.
The easier it is for them to come back to school and get back on track.
Right.
But then there, one of the comments said for finding childcare, one break was better than two, which, is a point too. You have to take care of kids.
Yeah. And that was what came out of our teacher advisory committee too when we discussed it as well. Instructional standpoint, it made sense, less disruption to your pacing guide. Which makes sense, and then also teacher wellness and mental health, like what was alluding to, is that you have shorter periods of time of a little bit of a break to get reacclimated as well, for your own sanity's sake at that point. And then, but from a parent's perspective, so then there was like sort of this competing lens where it said, when we have to take time off of work, it's very difficult to take vacations around that kind of a schedule if it's not a week. But that lens competes a little bit with the others, and I think the committee and the teacher advisory committee liked calendar one as well. For those reasons, instructional plus teacher mental health.
Okay. All right, thanks. Good discussion. I think we have concurrence. Yep. Thanks, Dr. Johnson.
9.2, the linchpin of supplemental basic aid that I talked about before, the Madison Agreement is here for your perusal. No changes from last year. We did speak to Anna Graham in Madison, and they were bringing this before their board last night as well. So it looks as though that's all going to be just fine. So that's there for you to vote on.
Thanks. Any questions on that?
9.3 is the well check, just as a check-in. Right now, I really have nothing to report. Cases are low in just about everything. Some, mild illnesses here and there, but not at the rate that we were seeing before. So, all is good.
Where are we with the clinic?
So, with the clinic, we had our final walkthrough and tech check meeting 2 weeks ago. So, on the urgent care side, Valley Health is just working out their memorandum of understanding and agreements to operate under a standing order for our nurses to be able to do point of care testing and treatment. So that's a great sign. So we should be up and running here very soon.
That's great.
Yes.
That's amazing. Thank you. The next thing is ESBA Business Honor Roll. We were at this point, intending to Warrenton Walmart was our 2023 honor roll. Let's see, it was our intent. I'll be asking you questions about that. Do you remember the role they were playing? The PTO came and introduced to us all the things they were going on.
They've gone far beyond the call of duty.
Yeah.
We'll be voting on that later. The next thing is the resolution, and we had hoped to do this with the Board of Supervisors, but the timing was not best. So they did this exact same resolution themselves Monday a week and sent it down. And Monday a week, and ours is going to be going down with Shannon in the morning, which would be great. Question: it's a lot to read. Should it be read in this meeting?
It can be.
Should it be? Yes.
Yes.
I shall read it. Resolution of support for HB 1443, removing the cap of supplemental basic aid to Rappahannock County. Whereas 22.1-98.2 Code of Virginia provides additional state funding for school divisions serving fewer than 1,100 students in the prior school year in a locality that is a local composite index of 0.6 or greater, as 65% or more of its local taxes generated from real estate taxes.
Yeah.
They enter in a cost savings or service sharing agreement with a contiguous school division which meets the criteria established by the Board of Education. And whereas this provision authorized the Virginia Department of Education to provide supplemental basic aid to qualified school divisions by calculating its state basic aid entitlement using the composite index of the contiguous school district involved in that agreement, and whereas Rappahannock County and Highland County are the only two school divisions in the Commonwealth that have ever used this provision, and whereas only four school divisions in the Commonwealth, including Rappahannock and Highland, qualify for this provision based on restrictive criteria of 22.1-98.2, and whereas only Rappahannock County's state entitlement is capped due to the enactment language of Chapter 589 of the 2008 General Assembly, which stated that the sum of basic aid and supplemental basic aid payments to Rappahannock County shall not exceed its FY 2007 basic aid payment of $1,129,208, and whereas this cap has not been revised to account for rising cost of inflation and almost negating the value associated with carrying out the contiguous cost-sharing agreement with Madison County, now therefore be it resolved, Rappahannock County School Board asks the General Assembly and the Governor to pass HB 1443, removing the limitation of any school division qualifying for adjustment of state share of the aid that capped the sum of basic aid payment and any supplemental basic aid payment to the basic aid payment appropriated to such locality by the 2007 session of the General Assembly, and be it further resolved that we deliver this resolution to state legislators, legislators representing Rappahannock County, and also Senate Finance and Education Committee chairs in the General Assembly of Virginia, adopted this day, 14th day of February 2023, to be signed by all of us. We'll vote on that shortly. We have a report. Is there anything, any comments there before we move on? Anyone?
No.
Yeah.
Great. It's going to be great.
Yeah, it's going
to
be great.
It? Who wrote that? Directive? That is really well done.
It's really well done. Thank you, Shannon. Yeah. Yeah, you did. So at this time, a report from our headquarters representative.
Headquarters has been busy as usual. I didn't get to meet in person with Ms. Ginoli this time, but she sent me a report. So we have the after school program, the partnerships with Totality, Martial Arts, and Verdun Adventure Bound are going well. There are 8 at Totality, Martial Arts, and 12 are going to Verdun once each week. The Drama Enrichment Club with after school is thriving with Lainey Vickers as the lead teacher. 12 students are working on the play Belle and That Beast Guy, which is a spinoff of Beauty and the Beast. Students will perform that play for the families at the end of the session, which that's great that they're performing for their families. That's nice. Of course they're doing that. And Reed has 12 children enrolled. She gave a breakdown, which is kind of interesting, of the ages of the students, 1 kindergartner, 1 first grader, 8 second graders, and 2 third graders. And Tiffany Montague, who is at RCES, is serving as a liaison between Reed and RCES teachers, and she's working with teachers to compile information
that volunteers can use to better support the students. And those plans should allow more progress to be seen by the end of the year. And the kindergarten team reached out to Headwaters to inquire about reading support during the school hours. And they were able to, recruit six volunteers to help students during the school day. The read program takes place after school, during the after school time. So that's good to have more support for the kindergartners, and that is successful and is already up and running after that request was made. Scholarships. The scholarship application for high school seniors closes February 24th, which is in 10 days. High school students are listening at home. They are working, students to submit the applications on time. And then there are 27 applicants so far for alumni renewal funding. So these are people who are graduates who have scholarships that they're looking to renew, and they will be awarding those funds soon. There are 9 Starfish mentoring pairs currently, and that's two additional pairs from the last time that we had this report. And there are 2 more children that are in the works to be paired with mentors. Coming into summer school planning, Headwaters is going to be supporting summer school every Monday to Wednesday through the month of June from 1 to 5. And students in summer school will receive enrichment similar to the after school program. They'll have outdoor time, enrichment club, and work on critical thinking and creativity skills through hands-on workshops. And then on Thursdays of each week, Jen and Capsa will take students to Graves Mountain Lodge as an incentive for participating in summer school. And hopefully that will mean more people will be participating. Another thing Headwaters is sponsoring in March, on Wednesday, March 8th, Headwaters is sponsoring a summer camp expo, which will have all the summer opportunities from the school or outside of the school. People will come and set up in this room, and people can shop for a summer camp for 2 or 3 for their students. It's a lot going on.
That was March the 8th.
It's going to be on March 8th, yeah, from 5 to 7 at this in the gym. So it's I think everybody is invited to come.
That is a busy bunch.
It is, yeah.
That's great.
And I'll send this.
Thank you. MBGS?
No, we did not meet. We're meeting this coming Thursday.
Okay. All right, moving on to public comment, but I'd like to address the board this evening. It's sparse. Anybody want to come speak to us about the budget this evening? Right, we're going to move on to action items. Is there a motion to approve the 2023-24 school calendar option 1?
So moved.
We have a motion, Mr. Gubin. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. Crowe. Any comments? Thanks for the work on that. And, it's documented very well. I like how it's laid out. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. So is there a motion to adopt the Madison Agreement for another year?
So moved.
Have a motion, Mr. Groves. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Ms. Bonham. Any comment? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. So is there a motion to approve the BSP Business Honor Roll for the warrant of Walmart?
So moved.
We have a motion, Ms. Bonham. Is there a second?
Second.
Second,
from
Ms. Meyer. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. It's ordered. Is there a motion? Who would like the honor of doing this?
Ms. Meyer.
To approve the resolution in support of HB 1443.
So moved. Everybody.
Who wants to second that?
Second.
Mr. Grove wants to second.
Yes.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. You better not. Motion carries. Is there any new business?
I just wanted to say that I talked to Shannon about deferring the scheduling discussion to next
that's
meeting.
Why?
Principal vice principal will probably be here. So.
Yeah, that's good.
But it hasn't been forgotten.
We did the high school scheduling primarily.
Yeah, high school scheduling.
But are there any items for requests for future agenda items?
We're still waiting, I think, on the solar stuff that Tom's put together, right?
Yes.
Do we have an idea when that's going to come around?
I know Robin did submit a grant to move that forward and get additional funding toward looking at different scenarios of funding. So I know she put in from starting with a smaller project to powering the oxygen to doing a full-scale cost saving. So we're waiting to see on what might come through for that.
All right, our next regularly scheduled support meeting is also a public hearing on the budget, March 14th, in this very same room at 6:30. And hopefully we'll know more by then. Much more.
So,
is there anything else? Is there a motion to move into closed session?
I move the board to convene into closed session for the following purpose: to discuss and consider the appointment of staff, the classified and coaching positions, retirement of classified positions, and discussion of the superintendent's goals pursuant to Virginia Code Section 2.2-3711A1.
We have a motion, Mr. Grove. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. Rubin. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. So we're going to be in closed session for, it could take
10 minutes.
Yeah, maybe not even.
5 to 10 minutes. We'll be back in.